Welcome, students. Today we are going to have the topic as understanding elementary shapes. This is a chapter of class 6th. We will be dealing with this chapter today, understanding elementary shapes. Before going into the chapter, you know, in our daily life we came across variety of the shapes. Like we have this ice cream cone. This is the cone shaped. Similarly, if we look at the clock, this is of the shape of circle. And the walls, of the room represent the square. If we have the, you know, equal dimensions across both the ends. Similarly, the table represents the rectangle. This kite represents the rhombus, and this ball represents the sphere. So, in short, giving details about these shapes, I am going to infer you that what these basic shapes are. These are not the only the basic shapes that are present there or that are in the, you know, syllabus, but giving a brief view about them, that what is going to be in the chapter. So we have the cone, rectangle, circle, rhombus, sphere, square. A brief view about what we are going to have in this chapter. So we will be dealing with what this point is. Then we will go to the line segment, line ray and line segment. Next we will see that how do we measure the line segment. Line segment kis tarah se hum measure karte hain. Next we will have the angles, details about the angles, what angle is and what are the different types of the angles. Next we will see how the angle is measured actually. And lastly, maybe today, that is, we will see what the triangle is and what are their different types of the triangles depending upon the size and depending upon the angle. So this is a gist of what we are going to have today. So the first question that might come in your mind, that why do we should have this elementary shape studied? The reason is that every other shape is formed by these elementary shapes. Like I am drawing a man, a rough sketch of the man, right? If we look at this figure, this head represents a circle, roughly. This represents a square. These extremes represent the rectangle. So we can say that the combination of these elementary shapes makes up the actual figure, right? So next we will have the starting point of this chapter that we are going to have is point. What point is? Point is said to be the basic geometric figure, or you can say basic geometric shape. Basic geometric shape is point, and it is said to be, you know, having no dimension. By no dimension, I mean we don't say it has some length, no length and no breadth. So point is dimensionless. We can't say that point is having some length or point is having some breadth, right? So why does this point comes in a real life? If we look at a starry night, the sitars represent the points. We can say each sitar is a point. Or if we look from a higher altitude, maybe we are in an aeroplane or we are at the high, some high mountain peak. When we look downwards, the houses or the objectives looks very basic points. Why do they look as a points? Because there is, we are at a high altitude and distance between the, you know, lower objects and us is very more. So these look as points when viewed from altitude, from height. By this height, we can be in aeroplane, in an aeroplane, or we can be at some mountain peak. Okay. So I hope you understood about this point. So point is the basic geometric shape, and by this, you know, basic geometric shape, we will be making other figures, other shapes. Once we are clear about this point, now if we look at these points, you know, this thing that I made here is nothing but a line. And how this line has been created? This line has been created by the combination of these points. This has been created by the combination of points. So there are, you know, number of points that are combined together to form a line. How do we define line as in mathematics? Line is defined as extending infinitely in both ends or from both ends. So we can say that there is no fixed point as far as the line is concerned, and it is extending infinitely from both ends, right? So this is line. So example of line can be, you can see, you know, line drawn around the globe, that is equator. Equator line we can assume it is a line because it is extending in both lines infinitely. Okay. Similarly, if we draw a line on the national highway, suppose this is a national highway and it is going continuously and we are drawing one line here. So this line is not having any end point, so we can consider this as a line, right? Next is the modification of the line that we call as ray. Ray is which is limited or fixed at one end. So it is having one, I will write first, fixed at one end. So it is having one end point and other side it is extending infinitely and extending infinitely at other end. So like this I can say this array. You can say this point is fixed and it is extending on from this side. The example of ray can be light of the torch. Suppose this is a torch and the ray is emitting from a torch light. So you can see that a light from a torch is infinitely extending from other side while it is fixed from one end. So this is called as ray. So we start with a point. Point was dimensionless. Then with the help of point we create a line which is extending on the both sides. Then with the help of ray as fixed at one end. Next we have further modification of this. You know, line was extending both sides. Ray is extending only one side. And further we have the line segment. Line segment, as the name itself suggests that, it is just a segment of the line. So, by segment of the line, we mean that it is fixed at both ends. It is fixed at both ends. So, if we having, you know, a line and we took a segment of it, suppose it is point A, it is point B. This is line segment. So, we can clearly see that there are two endpoints of it, endpoint A and endpoint B. And it is of the practical purpose, you know, most practical purpose is line segment, then the ray and the line. Now, what are the real life examples of this line segment? We will see that. If we look at a keyboard, and in keyboard, almost every key represents a line segment, but looking specifically at the space bar. Space bar represents an example of line segment. You can see that it is having the fixed ends. We can see that it is having the fixed ends. So, space bar of the keyboard, whether it is of the computer or anything else, it represents a line segment. Another examples that we can state of line segment, let it be the ladder and these be the steps. Each step in a ladder represents a line segment. So, this step, it is having the two endpoints. This is having the end two points. This two is having the end points. So, each step in a ladder represents this line segment. Furthermore, we can have the more examples of the line segment. If we look at the, let these be the two electric poles and this be the wire. So, we can see that this wire is again a line segment. How we can say that this is a line segment? You see that it is having the two fixed points at two poles. So, this entire length of the wire represents the line segment. Okay. So we can have more examples and you can think of them yourselves. Now, next we have, how do we measure this line segment? Suppose this is your house and this is your school, and we travel from house to school. Consider this house as a point and school also as a point. Further, let this be the house again, then let this be the playground. Now, this house and school, this house and playground represent the two ends of the line segment here. We can say that this is a line segment. Now, if I have to see which one is more and which one is less, there are three ways of doing it. What are these three ways? First way is by observation. By observation means that we can directly by seeing, you know, from very seeing of it, that which one is greater or which one is less. It doesn't need any instrument, it doesn't need any experimentation. Like I draw two lines, this is in line 1 and this is line 2. So, without, you know, if I say this line 1, this is line 2, without actually measuring it or performing any other thing on it, we can directly say that line 2 is greater. Line 2 is greater and line 1 is shorter. Line 1 is shorter. But the problem with this observation method is that it is used or it is beneficial only when there is a large difference between two lines. What if there is a very comparable difference? Like, I may draw two lines again. This is line 1 and this is line 2. Here we can't say that at once, you know, by looking at it by observation point of view, we can't say that line 1 is greater or line 2 is greater. So we need some other method for doing it, right? So other method of doing it is by using a ruler. So ruler in, you know, layman terms, what we call as, we call it as a scale. This is a ruler. We call in, you know, layman terms, we call it a scale. So if we measure it like this, let me draw, you know, lines of the comparable, you know, shorter, so that we can use our ruler. Okay. So using it, we can see that it is all, you know, approximately 13, and here it is 14. So when it was of the comparable length, that is, the length is not, you know, when there is not much difference between the two lines, we have to use the ruler, or what we call as a scale in layman terms, right? So far we had only two methods. Now we will go for the third method. So I hope you understood that by observation method, when there is not, you know, much difference between the two lines, we have to use the ruler. Now there is some problem with the ruler too, right? That is called positioning error. What is this positioning error? Is that our eye must be vertically over the scale. Otherwise, you know, we may calculate results wrongly. So the third method is by using divider. What this divider is, we will look at it. So this is our divider. We will be using it, you know, to compare the lengths of the two lines. Suppose I have to, you know, these two lines, keeping, you know, the one end of the fixed and extending it on the other side, I can see that this fixed, you know, this fixes to this part. Now what I, if you know, go to this part, you can see that there is some part left behind. There is some part left behind, and this part is left behind. Now the question may arise in our mind that this divider can be used only for comparing. You know, as such notion arises, हमारे दिमाग में ऐसा आएगा कि इससे हम खाली कंपेयर कर पाएंगे. जैसे फिर से मैं दो लाइन्स बना रहा हूं, ये दो लाइन्स है मेरे पास, ठीक है. वंस आई कैन यूज दिस टू कंपेयर. नाउ इफ आई यू नो पुट दिस ऑन दिस, यू कैन सी दैट देर इज अ सम पार्ट विच इज नॉट कवर्ड इन अवर डिवाइडर. नाउ इट इज नॉट लाइक दैट इट इज ओनली यूज फॉर द कंपेयरिंग. But with the help of this ruler, we can also measure the actual length. Like once we put it on this part, then we will use the ruler to calculate the length that we, you know, that we have by this method. So we can use it. So it says that our length is 13. So the combination of ruler and divider makes it possible to calculate the exact length too. So this was, you know, till this point, what we studied is, we start with a point, we go to the line, then the line segment, then in fact a ray, then the line segment, and then we measured it by three methods. Next. Next thing that we are going to have is going to study the angle. What angle is? Angle is nothing but the orientation orientation between two lines or two surfaces. Between two lines or two surfaces with common vertex point. With common vertex point. So, what this statement means to us? You know, suppose we will see it says orientation between two lines or two surfaces with common vertex point. So, it is all that matters is the orientation between two surfaces that makes the angle. Suppose this is one surface, this one hand, my one hand represents one surface and my other hand represents other surface. So, at the moment, both are lying in the same orientation. By orientation, I mean direction. So, you know, keeping the lower hand as fixed and moving the upper hand. So, we can see that the angle is increasing gradually, slowly, right? So, the orientation of upper hand is changing, right? Similarly, we can say of the geometry box, you know, earlier, initially, this upper surface and lower surface are at the same orientation, is in the same direction. Now, as I move the lid, you can see that the orientation, the angle between the two is increasing. The orientation between one surface and another surface is increasing. You can see that here it reaches at the half point and here it reaches the full point. So, I hope we understood what do we mean by the orientation between the two lines or the two surfaces. We make use of this, you know, when the hands of the clock, we have all have seen the clock, you know, this hands of the clock, when the hands of the clock move, they make an angle, right? Suppose they are at the same point at the moment, okay. After some time, the clock, the hands of the clock may reach here, suppose. And after some time, the hands of the clock may reach here. And in further, they may reach again to this point. Before moving further, this circle will be divided into four quadrants, four parts. Let be the one quadrant, this be the second, this be third, this be fourth. So, if the hand of the clock reaches from this to this point, so this means it has completed 1 by 4th quadrant or 1 by 4th part. If it composes 1 by 4th quadrant or 1 by 4th part, we call it as a right angle. And it is called as 90 degree. Second, if it completes the two parts, the two quadrants, this quadrant 1, and this quadrant 2. So, it completes two quadrants, we call it as a straight angle. And further, if it completes the whole, all the quadrants, this quadrant 1, this quadrant 2, this quadrant 3, this quadrant 4, we call it as a straight angle. We call it as a complete angle, sorry. We call it this complete angle. So, by the hands of the clock, we get a gist of this angles that if it completes the one half of the revolution, it is called a straight angle. If it completes the 1/4 of the quadrant, it is called as right angle. And if it completes all the quadrants, revolving all the quadrants, it is called as complete angles. Furthermore, what if it completes less than 90, in between 0 and 90, it is called as acute angle. And what if it create, it makes greater than 90, greater than 90, it is called as obtuse angle. So, acute is if it makes less than 90, less than 1 by 4th of the quadrant, and obtuse it if it makes more than 1 by 4th or the 90 and less than 180. And furthermore, what if it makes more than 180 and less than 360? That's called a reflex angle. So, we may wrap up here. Before wrapping up, I may, you know, remind you again what we have done so far. We started with the basic elementary shapes, then we reached to the point, what the point is, then we have the line segment, ray, and finally we talked about the angles, what the angle is and what are the different types of the angles. We may make further, you know, deliberation on it, but that will be next time. Thank you very much.